So water pills. Those are your diuretics. Basically, they just help the kidneys make more urine and get rid of the excess fluid. The diuretics that you'll be seeing the most of and are the ones that we use now are Lasix, Bumex, Demodex, hydrochlorothiazide, and then there's one called Ziroxilin or Metolazone, and I call that the booster. As patients begin to build up fluid, they may need a higher dose of the water pills just to increase the effectiveness. And that's why I like to go back to drugs like Ziroxilin or Metolazone. And I nicknamed it the booster because I would teach my patients if they began to experience fluid buildup and if the water pills quit working, we would sometimes use Metolazone once or twice a week just to augment and increase their urine output. Also, if we have them on max doses of Lasix or Bumex, we can also use Ziroxilin to, again, enhance diuresis. So there are ways to get rid of this excess water without putting them in the hospital. And and I keep saying this, just remember that diuretics lose their effectiveness when patients build up fluid. The gut is edematous, there's a barrier, so as the patient takes their pills, they don't absorb all the medicine and it just gets passed on. So you might hear them say to you, you know, I'm not urinating as much as I used to, and that should be a key for you to think, I wonder if they're building up fluid. When patients are markedly volume up with acute symptoms, meaning they're very short of breath, they're very uncomfortable, we usually will administer the diuretic in the IV form. And we can do that in the emergency room, we can do that in the office. Home health can also do this at home. So this is a great way to bypass that edematous gut, get rid of some extra fluid, and eventually make the water pills work more effectively. With all diuretics, we need to monitor electrolytes very closely, especially the serum potassium, renal function, like the BUN and creatinine, and serum sodium. These can all elevate using lots of diuretics. Potassium usually requires replacement of some sort, and we're all used to that. And let's talk about that for a moment. We know that the body needs potassium. Heart rhythm depends on a normal potassium level, so it's so important that we monitor potassium levels and make sure they don't get too low. And we know that food alone cannot replace the amount of potassium that's removed by the diuretic, so we have to give it to them in other forms. These are all very familiar to you guys. K-DOR, micro-K, KCL, I call them the horse pills, the big, thick, white pills that we give all of our patients, or the nasty orange liquid that we make them drink. But many of our patients need to be on these to keep the potassium levels where they should be. I'm also going to talk about two medications, aldactone and inspra. These are potassium-sparing diuretics, and we're using these a lot more in heart failure, and let me tell you why. These potassium-sparing diuretics are, again, very mild diuretics, so the patient won't notice that they're urinating a little bit more, but it tells your kidneys to hold on to potassium, so it won't let the potassium leave the body. Again, the two drugs that we use are aldactone or spironolactone and inspra, and the other name for that is eplerenone. When we use these drugs, it can also elevate the potassium, so we have to watch potassium very closely. Another added benefit and why we're using these drugs more often is we found that these drugs block a stress hormone called aldosterone. And again, heart failure patients make an excessive amount of aldosterone. Aldosterone causes retention of water and retention of salt, and also it can make the heart failure worse. So we have found in studies like the Rouse trial that blocking this hormone can prevent heart failure from getting worse. And what I like is it prevents those patients from taking those big horse pills. There's also sources of potassium in our diets. We all know about bananas, but there's many others. And just looking at this slide, you'll see that, you know, raisins and prunes, avocados, tomatoes, beans and peas, grapefruits, oranges, those are all very great resources for potassium. I had this one patient, every December, he would come in and get labs drawn during the month, and his potassium was always high. And we hadn't changed his medicines, everything remained the same, and we came to find out that he would get those little baskets of dried fruits every, you know, for Christmas, And he would eat dried apricots, dried prunes, and his potassium was following in suit because he was consuming a lot more potassium. So if you start seeing things like that, ask them, what are you eating? What are you doing? Just so you know. And another big problem with high potassiums are the use of salt substitutes. Because since we tell these patients to limit their amount of sodium intake, they will use salt substitutes. And all salt substitutes use potassium chloride instead of sodium chloride. And it's a little saltier than salt, but that might be a source for potassium.